Find Hope Here is all about finding beauty in the brokenness of our lives. And in season one, we are going to jump right in and start talking about sexual brokenness. Not just that, but also God's heart to redeem and restore those of you who are carrying sexual shame. Why in the world am I starting my podcast here? Well, let me tell you a little story. About 6 years ago, I had a little furniture business. I would go to garage sales or pick things up off the side of the road that people discarded or thought were worthless. And I would take them home. I would take that furniture home, sand it, paint it, turn it into something beautiful and sell it. And so I opened a little business named, of all things, Beauty in the Brokenness. And just as it was getting off to a start, I remember one day my sister and I went shopping in our cute little downtown of Medina, Ohio. Shout out to Medina. I still miss you. And as I was there, I realized that this was a really common thing. As a matter of fact, I was walking through store after store and I was like, you have got to be kidding me. Everyone is painting furniture. And right as I kind of muttered those words to myself, I heard in my mind, not audibly, but I heard this little voice say to me, but no one else can tell your story. And I had this little argument going with God, and I think it was God that was saying that to me. I was like, well, nobody cares about my story. Nobody wants to hear my story. And God was like, tell it anyway. And I was like, well, my story is a little bit messy. Like, I really don't want to tell my story. And honestly, I've been fighting that for a good 6 years, I would say. I did begin to share my story. I actually started speaking at different events. And as I did, I found a freedom. You see, mine is a story of sexual brokenness and shame. Even after I came to faith in Jesus and went to Bible college, even after I started serving in ministry as a pastor's wife, I felt like shame just would not loosen its grip on me. It would whisper things to me like, if only they knew, you don't belong, you're not good enough. And for so many years, I endured this silent shame, and I assumed I would take it to my grave. But as I began my speaking ministry, I realized how many women were sitting in churches, or worse yet, were staying away from churches because of those same lies. Women whose hearts needed to learn about the healing restoration of Jesus. And then as I studied scripture, I just was completely overwhelmed by the number of sexually broken women that the Bible talks about. And I'm not talking about just like these little sideline players. I'm talking about like headliners, big time players, women that God wove into his story and shined a spotlight on. He looked down and said, I choose you to include in my family line. I mean, just think about the line of Jesus that's listed in Matthew 1. There are some sketchy characters in that genealogy. Tamar is the first woman mentioned. She seduced her father-in-law. I bet you never heard that story in your Sunday school class. Rahab, who was a prostitute. Bathsheba, who was raped by the king of Israel. Ruth, who was a Moabitess. I don't know if you know anything about the Moabites, but they descended from this incestuous line of Lot and his daughter. Next is Mary. And although we know that Mary was pure and innocent, she was not seen that way. She was seen as sexually immoral. And it just amazes me that those women that God chose to highlight, all of them had some form of sexual brokenness. And then we look at the New Testament and we look at all the women that Jesus sought out, spent time with, rescued, and restored. The woman at Simon's house, that sinful woman who came in and anointed Jesus' feet. You know, in that story, she was kind of seen as, why would this woman be here touching Jesus? And yet Jesus turned toward her. He lifted her up And he kind of put Simon in his place. The woman caught in adultery, the woman at the well, Jesus didn't just restore her. He identified himself to her in ways that he didn't even tell his disciples. You know, what these stories tell me is that Jesus doesn't just see the sexually wounded or the sexually broken as women to be cast aside, but those to whom he extends himself. It's as if he says, you see that one there, that woman who's wounded and broken? I choose her. I choose her to build my kingdom, to fill my family tree. It's easy to find our identity in labels. But Jesus says, your identity is not in the labels that you wear. It's in the description that I give you. Forgiven, daughter, righteous, faith-filled, blessed. These are the women that Jesus came through and for. These women with the messy lives and the sketchy backgrounds. It's like he says, these are my people. These are my girls. These are the ones I'm building my kingdom through. So we, the sexually wounded, are part of a vast lineage of strong, brave women that God used and is still using to build his kingdom. As I learned about these women, I realized how much freedom their stories gave me. And I realized if God is not ashamed of them, then I don't need to hide, and neither do you. If he can redeem and restore them, he can do the same for you and me. As I began to understand God's heart of compassion and grace toward these women and his posture toward them that he's always turning toward, he's always pursuing, always looking to rescue and redeem, I actually found so much freedom in my own life. And so as we begin this podcast series, in season one, I'm talking about six sexually wounded women from Scripture. But I don't want you to tune me out if you're like, hey, that's not my story. The fact is, all of us are walking a broken road of one way, of one sort or another. And so please stick with me. I'm going to go ahead and share my story with you. But even if it's not the same as yours, I know that God is desiring to rescue you from whatever brokenness it is that you're walking through. I like to start my story by always asking people, have you ever seen My Big Fat Greek Wedding? Because if you have, you've basically seen my story, my family, on the big screen, except we were Italian and not Greek. I grew up in a home that was Catholic, very, very strong Catholic. We actually went to the Latin-speaking Mass, even though nobody in our house speaks or understands Latin. I was the youngest of six kids. My parents had five kids in 6 years, and then 7 years later, I was born. So I spent my childhood watching my teenage siblings experiment with things like drugs and alcohol and sex. And as a good Catholic, I knew they were going to spend a long time in purgatory. So I came up with a better plan. I was going to party as much as possible throughout my life. And when I got old, I was going to become a nun to make up for all the sins I planned to commit. And I am not joking. That was my plan. I'd say I had a relatively happy childhood in suburban America. But there's some things in our lives that define us. And when I was in second grade, I had my innocence taken. And I was terrified. As a matter of fact, I was threatened not to tell anybody because we would both get in a lot of trouble. And so I went to my neighbor, who was a big fifth grader, because I thought, surely she'll know what to do. She didn't really say much, but the next week, when I got on the school bus, everybody was laughing and pointing and saying obscene things. And I knew that my secret was out. As I walked to the back of the school bus, I made a silent promise to myself that I will never tell anyone again. That started a 6-year pattern in my life of abuse, secrecy, fear, shame, and anger. You know that saying, hurt people, hurt people? Well, I became a little bit of a bully when I was in fifth grade. I went to Billy Joe's house. And I went there to beat her up, but her grandma chased me away and told me she was going to call juvie if I didn't get off their porch. So I stopped beating up on Billy Joe, but I found a new target for my anger, a target that was always available, and that was me. I think that's part of what led to that voice in my head that always said, not good enough, not good enough. I tried to be a good athlete and student and friend, but I always felt like I fell short. I was never thin enough or pretty enough. I wasn't ever a good enough daughter or sister or wife or mom or friend or anything. I don't know if you can relate to that. It's something I still wrestle to this day. But back to my story, I'm going to fast forward about 6 years. At this point, I am in the throes of middle school. Okay. I don't know about you, but when I think of middle school, I just want to like, it was the worst. Meanwhile, I was dealing with 6 years of abuse, anxiety, insecurity, self-doubt, and I had become a little bit promiscuous by the time I was in middle school. So when my parents asked me if I wanted to go to camp, my first question was, will there be boys there? Because if there were, I'd be in. But if they were going to send me to some Catholic all-girls camp, I wasn't really interested. Anyway, they said, yes, there would be boys. So I went to camp, and it was a Bible camp, which meant nothing to me because I had actually never, up to that point in my life, even seen a Bible. I got there, and my dad opens the trunk, and I've got 7 pieces of luggage. I had a suitcase just for makeup, and I wasn't even allowed to wear makeup, but I had it with me. So I had a great week of camp. The last night, we were circled up in our little teepees. We had stayed in a part of the camp called Teepee Town, and our counselor handed out slips of paper, and she said, I just want you to write yes or no on this paper. Have you ever asked Jesus to be your savior? And I said, no. I wrote down no. I handed it in. I leaned over to my little camp friend, and I was like, what did you write? And she was like, yes. And all of a sudden, I started paying attention. I hadn't really paid any attention to anything. None of the songs made sense to me. I didn't know how to find anything in a Bible. And so I kind of dismissed all of that Bible stuff. I was there for the boys. But for the first time this night, I thought, oh, maybe I should pay attention to this. And I started listening. And our counselor was explaining that Jesus had died on the cross for our sins and that we were all sinners. Now, if you'll remember my little life plan, I knew I was a sinner. I was in the sin as much as possible stage of my life. So nobody had to convince me that I was a sinner. And she was explaining that Jesus died on the cross for our sins. Well, growing up Catholic, we had a crucifix in every room of our house. I knew Jesus died on the cross. But for the first time in my life, I understood the connection that God wanted a relationship with me. I was a bratty, foul-mouthed, promiscuous teenager. But because of Jesus, I could be in a relationship with the God of the universe. And I remember so clearly that night, I was bedded down in my little sleeping bag. And out of the top of the teepee, I could see the sky because there was a hole in the top and I could see the sky. And I remember praying this stumbling on my own prayers that went something like, Jesus, my life is a mess. I want you to take over. I had no idea that that moment was going to change my life forever. That was my defining moment. It gave meaning to everything that had happened in my life up to that point and everything that would happen since. And I always love to say, God rescued me on so many levels. I was going down a path of self-destruction. And God turned me around. He just started making changes in my life and in my heart that I didn't even understand then. I know now it was the Holy Spirit. Also, He gave me courage to stand up to my abuser. For the first time, I said, no, no, you will never touch me again. And He didn't. Ephesians 2 says this, and you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind. And we were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. And I just want to point out a few words in that passage. First of all, it says we were dead. You know what? A corpse doesn't bring much to the table in our trespasses. And that word just means to commit an offense. Yes, I had offended God. Obviously, offenses had been committed against me as well. But I was a sinner, and I had offended God with my own choices and my own decisions. It says that we were children of wrath. All of us, apart from God's grace, deserve his punishment. But my favorite words are those two words in the middle, but God, because of his mercy, love, grace, kindness, he made me alive spiritually. And you know, as I've wrestled with that whole idea of telling my story, I'm going to tell my story, I'm not going to tell my story, and arguing with God about it. Several years ago, I heard this song, and it has kind of been a theme that I have adopted for myself. It's a song by Point of Grace, and in it they say, I have not lived a life that boasts of anything, and I don't take pride in what I bring, but I'll build an altar with the rubble that you found me in, and every stone will sing of what you can redeem. Heal the wound, but leave the scar, a reminder of how merciful you are. And you know what? That's why I tell my story. That's part of the reason, is that God has taken that wound and turned it into a scar. And I feel like when we show our scars, we show God's power to heal us. But the other reason I like to tell my story is because I know that you who are listening have scars too. All of us do. Maybe yours is abuse or addiction or an abortion or divorce or illness. I don't know. But I do know that something in your life is broken because we live after the fall. God created this world perfect. He put a man and a woman in a garden, and he created us for a relationship with him. But he gave us the freedom to choose. And we chose rebellion and sin. And every one of us since the time of Adam and Eve have been born into a fallen, broken world. Because God is holy, he does not coexist with sin. He couldn't just sweep it under the rug. He has to punish it. But God wanted so badly to have that relationship with us back that he set up a sacrificial system. And in the Old Testament, they would sacrifice animals, goats, bulls, lambs, and it was that blood that would pay for the penalty of sin. It wasn't really their blood. It was the symbol of blood that would one day be spilt. All of those sacrifices pointed ahead to Christ. When he came, John said of him, "Behold the Lamb of God." See, God chose to pour out his wrath on his very own son. Philippians 2 says this, Jesus, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he made himself nothing. Think about God, the God who created the universe, scrunching himself up into the womb of a teenage girl, by taking the very nature of a servant, and that word literally means slave, being made in human likeness, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. Because, you know, Jesus didn't say, okay, God, I'll go to that sin-cursed earth and let me just die in my sleep. That would be so much easier. I mean, Jesus knew blood needed to be shed. And he didn't just say, let me be beheaded, because there would still be blood, but it would be quick and painless. He died the most horrific, painful death known to man. In Isaiah 53, it says that by his wounds, we are healed. That the punishment that brought us peace with God was laid on Christ. And I always thought of Isaiah 53 as a passage which talked about the forgiveness of our sins, and it does. But also, in verse 4, it says, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. What are the griefs and sorrows that you're carrying today? Jesus took those to the cross. He experienced the pain of those, and he grieves with you. You know, as I have come to the place of sharing my story, I think one of the biggest things that has given me the courage to do so is getting to know these women in Scripture. These women that have played such a big role in setting me free from shame, which is why I actually have written a Bible study about this, which I'm hoping to publish in the spring. But I want to talk about another verse, one more verse that I want to share with you. Psalm 34:5 says, those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. And that word radiant, it means to shine or sparkle like a bubbling brook. If you've ever been out in like in front of a lake or a pond in the summer, and you see like, it almost looks like diamonds just shimmering and sparkling. That's the word. Those who look to him, who turn their faces toward him, are radiant. And they're never covered with shame. And that word shame means to be disgraced or humiliated. When we look to him, when we turn our faces toward the Lord, he changes them from shame to shining. What a beautiful picture. And that's what I hope that this podcast will do. It will help us to turn our faces to the Lord. It will help us to eradicate shame and to become women who are radiant. And just to kind of give you an overview of how this podcast will work, I'm following the format of the Bible study that I'm writing, and it's called Graced, 6 Biblical Women Restored from Sexual Shame. So over the next few months, we are going to grow in our friendship with women like Rahab and Bathsheba and the woman at the well and others. We're going to go through their stories one at a time. So on week 1, I'm going to tell their story, and we're going to identify their brokenness and how God restored them. And then in the second week of each woman, we're going to look at a psalm. I think the psalms are so beautiful. They're so healing to us. They provide insight into God's tender heart. And we will talk about things like what it means to find our thirsty souls satisfied by God. We'll talk about how God has our backs and how he chases us down with kindness and mercy. And I am super excited about week 3 of each woman, because on week 3, we are going to do a guest interview. And it might be a woman who can give us insight on maybe the story that we're studying, like Carolyn Custis James. I actually had a conversation with her that I can't wait to share with you about what it means for a woman to step into her role as an image bearer. And she's going to talk to us about Tamar and just what an amazing thing that Tamar did. Or it might be a woman whose story resonates with a woman in Scripture, like Angie Bauman, who relates to the sinful woman at Simon's house who anointed Jesus' feet. I'm telling you, when I think of Angie's story, I get chills. This is going to be an amazing season. These women are going to provide so much truth and encouragement for your heart. I can't wait to air those episodes. And make sure you subscribe so you don't miss any of them. Now, if you're non-techie like me, I think I'm going to be able to give you a little bit of direction here. So if you're listening on Spotify, press the follow button. If you're on Apple, click the little plus sign that's up in the corner. If you're on the podcast app, click the star. I'm not really sure. I wish they would just make it the same and just click a little button that says subscribe, but for whatever reason, they don't. You can always go to my website, teresawhiting.com/listen, and I will have my podcasts there. But anyhow, my hope for season one is to bring women who have experienced sexual brokenness to a place of freedom from shame. And you might not get there all the way, but maybe if you could just take a few steps closer. Also, I would love to help you come to a deeper understanding of God's heart, His love for you, and His desire to write a beautiful story over your life. Maybe this podcast is for you. Maybe you're listening and you're like, yes, I am resonating with this, everything that she has said so far. Maybe you hear those same voices that I heard for so long. If only they knew. I don't belong. I'm not one of them. Or maybe this podcast is for someone you know, someone who felt safe enough to confide in you about her own brokenness. So I'm dedicating this season to all the women out there who have experienced sexual brokenness. Maybe you were raped or abused by a relative, or maybe you were sexually active and had an abortion. I don't know your story, but God does, and He's not afraid of it, and He's not ashamed of it. He wants to actively do the beautiful work of restoring and redeeming your life from sexual shame. Here's to season one.